paraphrasing and reading them from Acts. And we've been talking about resurrection faith, looking at faith of the apostles and the people after the resurrection of Christ and how it changed and what great things they did. And so today we're going to talk about courage unleashed as we look at the courage of John and Peter. So let's begin in prayer. Now, Lord, put our hearts to your word. Let us stand strong in your love and your grace. Let us remember it only you that matters. Lord, help us, Lord, to live in the strength that you give us. In your name, amen. I've been studying, I think I've done this for years. Once or twice a year, I'll buy a couple of the, quote, scholarly books that are out there, the books that they use in colleges and so forth on who Jesus is and what Christianity is. And if you don't know, most of them don't believe at all in Jesus or in the Bible at all. They believe it's a bunch of stories that are made up. In fact, the one book that I'm reading now lists 8 different ideas of who Jesus really was, because we really can't tell, because they refuse to believe that he was God. So therefore, they come up with everything from him being an apostolic prophet declaring the end of the world to a moral teacher who just wanted people to get along. It's amazing how hard they work at trying to prove that Jesus is not who he says he is. And Jesus is not God, he is not our Savior, that he didn't rise from the dead. And they go to great lengths to try to prove that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. But no matter how they do it, what argument they use, the truth is there are 2 questions that modern scholars cannot answer. 2 questions that no matter what they say, they still are stuck with. And the obvious ones will admit it. The first question is, who moved the stone? Who moved the stone? Because we know historically Jesus was not in the tomb. Now again, you can't prove historically he rose from the dead, but we can prove the body was gone. Okay? Well, the women didn't do it. The stone weighed about a ton and a half. That was the standard for those days. That was normal. Okay? The guards weren't going to do it because for them to lose the body meant they were going to be killed. The Pharisees didn't want to do it because they had invested interest in keeping Jesus in the tomb. They wanted to make sure that everybody knew he was a fraud. And the disciples were across town scared, hiding in a room, not coming out because they were too afraid they were going to get arrested and killed. So who moved it?
2 angels.
If you don't believe Christ did, you got a problem. The second question, what we're going to focus on today, is what happened to the disciples? Every historian, every modern scholar has struggles with the problem, what happened to the disciples? One day these guys are wimps, the next day they're warriors. One day they're chickens, the next day they're lions. One day they're hiding in a room, the next day they're going out and changing the world, and literally these 11 men changed the world more than any other group ever has in history. What happened to them? What would turn a couple of 11 guys who were so wimpy that when Christ died, they either went in or they went back home, which is where Christ talks about, into these warriors that changed the world? There's no psychological, there's no sociological reason for it. There's no answer to that question unless Jesus is who he said he was. Unless they saw their Savior. Unless the resurrection is true. And we know it is. And today we're going to look at one of the stories about them and realize exactly what it means that they saw and the resurrected Lord, that the resurrection happened for them. We're going to talk about the text today, but I'm going to back you up a little bit. So we're going back up to chapter 4, chapter 3. Peter and John, this is after Jesus rose from the dead, are going to the temple to pray. Nice, easy day. You know, nothing too bad. You don't get too much trouble going to church, do you? You know? They do. They end up getting thrown in jail. But they get to the church, and there's a cripple out there. And this is how the story goes. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now, a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going to the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, and then John, and Peter said, "Look it up." So the man gave his attention, expecting to get something from him. And Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." And taking him by the right hand, he helped him up. And instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. And he went with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Pretty cool thing. You think by that I would really make somebody's day to actually see healing. But he got thrown in jail. Because the temple priests come up and see what's happening, and they call the guards, and they literally throw Peter and John in jail for healing somebody. Now, I don't know about you, I've never spent a night in jail, thank goodness. I really don't want to. I don't know if any of you who have, and unfortunately I've known a lot of people who spent a night in jail. And he did once? Yeah, alright, figures. And that's the whole point. I've never heard anybody say it was their best experience. In fact, usually most people say after spending night in jail, they don't want to go back. Well, Peter and John, and jails back then didn't have beds and nice things. It was a cold floor, rock floor, and damp and miserable and everything else. Anyway, they spend the night, and the next day they get brought up in front of the judges, the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin asked them just one question. Just one question that cut to the heart of it. They asked him, "By what power did you do this?" They don't ask him, "How did you do this?" They didn't ask him, "Why you did this?" They ask him, "By what power did you do this? What is the power that gives you the ability to do this?" They couldn't argue that it was done. The healed, the crippled guy was there with them. So he's not crippled now. Nobody could argue that. The question they ask is, where did you get your power? Where did you get the ability to do that? Now remember, this is the same group that just a few weeks ago killed Christ. Okay, this is the same group of people who judged him and claimed him as blasphemous and slapped him on the face and spit in the face and everything else and then sent him out to be killed. So obviously, they're not real big excited about Jesus. And so they blunt out and ask him. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'm standing in front of a group that could literally throw away the key and just forget about me in jail, worse stone me, which you had the right to do, or beat you to death, flog you to death, or just crucify you, things like that, I might think twice about my answer. You know, you could do the politician's thing and just make it generic. Well, it was a gift of God. You know, nice and simple. You could do the teenage approach, which is, "I don't know." No?
Yes.
But that's not what Peter and John do. Listen to what they say. "And Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, 'Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account for a day of an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame, and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but who God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under by heaven given mankind by which we must be saved. Peter not only answered him, but you catch the three things he said? He said, A, we did it by Jesus' name. What are you going to do about it? B, you're the ones who killed him. You're the ones who killed God's anointed. It's all your fault. And number three, you're all going to hell because there's only one way to heaven now, and that's Jesus. And so you guys are all going to hell. Now, it's not advisable to tell a judge you're going to hell. Okay, you ever do get front of one? All right, not a good thing to do. But they stand up and they do this, knowing how much these people hate Jesus, knowing what they did to destroy Jesus, knowing what they did to get rid of Jesus. They stand up and say those three things, man. Jesus did it, you killed him, and you're going to hell because of it. Unless you repent. Obviously, it blew the minds of the people, the judges, the Sanhedrin. In fact, the very next verse, one of my favorite verses of Scripture, says, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. You see, the real question becomes that for us. What gave them that courage? What gave them the courage to stand up in front of people who just put them in jail for overnight? Literally could have been in jail for the rest of their lives if they wanted to. What gave them the courage to stand up and say, it was by the power of Jesus, the guy who killed, God raised from the dead, the one that salvation is found in. What gave them that kind of courage? Because I don't know about you, there are times in my life that I would just love to stand up and do that sometime to somebody. You know? There are times in my own family where I just love to say, get a life, grow up, and realize that God's the answer, and stop being so stupid. There's times when I used to work out and not pastor. There are times I just wanted to grab someone and say, wake up, you're headed for hell. Repent! I mean, wouldn't you just love to be like Jonah? I always thought Jonah would be so cool. You know, you've been in the belly of a whale for 3 days. You're bleached white from the stomach acid. You got seaweed hanging from you. You walk up out of the sea. Some fishermen standing there looking at you with seaweed dripping off you. And you say, repent. I repent. I mean, you know, just love to do that. What gave these guys? Of all, they'd seen the other side of the grave. They'd seen the resurrected one. They saw what happens when they die and come back, and what God will do for all of us who believe in Him and are resurrected to eternal life. They saw that. They experienced it. They saw the other side of the grave. After you've seen the other side, you know what? That doesn't scare you too much. The Bible says, it's what you worry about, what people can do to you. Why do you get worried about it? You never worry about what people can do to you physically. Worry about the one who can send you to heaven. That's God. And once you see, death is nothing. And what can you do to you? Second thing that gave them strength is they had seen the witness of real life. They saw the Savior who lived with them for 3 years, who ate with them, slept with them, worked with them, literally give his life for them. That's the message of the cross. That's what it's about. That Jesus gave his life for us. Man, we talk about love today, but I don't think people would do that. I'm not sure I know any. They experienced what it was to be loved so much that God would face hell on the cross for you. For me. And that's what he did. The third thing, experienced grace. Can you imagine what Peter must have been like after Jesus died? You know what happened, right? What did Peter do? We denied him three times, right? And if you read the book of Luke, it tells you that after he did the third time, the rooster crowed, and Jesus looked at Peter. And what did Peter do? He ran and he broke down and cried. He went in. Imagine what that would be like if you knew someone, just take someone you love, the last words out of your mouth that they knew you said, was denying them or condemning them or screaming at them. How would you feel?
Creepy.
And what does Jesus do? After he resurrects from the dead, he goes to Peter and he says, you know what? It don't matter. Just do you love me? That's all I ask. Do you love me? Yesterday doesn't matter. The day before doesn't matter. Just go and feed my sheep. Go and show them what I show you. They've experienced what it means to truly be forgiven. We lift it from the garbage pit that we get ourselves into emotionally and lift it back up and said, hey, you're worth everything. And I gave everything for you. Number four, I think, is the one that we don't realize today. Peter and John realized who held the power. The Pharisees and Sadducees running that court didn't hold any power. Because they realized who owned the power? God. They had just watched Jesus being crucified. They had just watched everything they believed seem to fall apart. Everything they spent their life, 3 years of their life, working towards, suddenly went up in smoke on Good Friday. It looked like the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Romans and everybody else had won against Jesus, who stood up and wanted to teach someone about love, teach us about grace. And evil destroyed. And then 3 days later, they found out it was God's plan all along. 3 days later, they realized the Pharisees had nothing to do with them. Or the Sadducees, or Pilate, or the Romans who shoved the nails in the hand. They realized it was God's plan all along. God was in charge the whole time. Do we understand that? We understand when things go bad that God's in charge. That God won. I didn't do this earlier. I'm a little political here. Just because the political season is so much fun. You get 4 years for the sermons illustration just out of one political season. You know? Anyway, Donald Trump always goes, we're going to win. We're going to win again. America's going to win again. I don't care whether you like Donald Trump or not. That's not the issue. Do you realize Donald Trump is, even if he becomes president, is not in charge? Barack Obama's not in charge. Hillary Clinton's not in charge. Bernie Sanders not in charge. Doesn't matter who it is. God's in charge. And with God, we win. God says even if you lose your life, you win. Because I'm in charge. And I won't ever leave you forsaken. So, literally, these guys had the courage to live for their faith to the point that all of them except John were killed for their faith. All of them. Peter was crucified under the Roman Emperor Nero. Andrew was scourged and then crucified, but they didn't want him to die too fast, so they just tied him up instead of putting the nails in his hands, and he hung there for 2 days. And while he was on that cross for 2 days, he was preaching to people who were walking by. They always put the cross right by the road, so he had to go by it so to see what bad people they got. Can you imagine that? Walking into town and seeing a guy hanging the cross and he's telling you about forgiveness. James the Greater, or brother John, he was killed with a sword. He was beheaded. John was the only one of the original disciples not to die a violent death. Instead, he got stuck in the penal colony on Patmos and died in a penal colony. Philip was scourged, thrown into prison, and crucified, 54 AD. Bartholomew, they're not sure matter how he died, it's two different ideas, two different traditions. The first one, they beat him and then crucified him, which is probably better than the second one. The second one is they skinned him alive and cut his head off. I think that's the first one.
I'm not sure.
Thomas was run through with a spear. Matthew was literally stabbed in the back by a cave circle the king set after him. James, the other James, was beaten and stoned by persecutors, and then killed by getting beaten by the head of the club. Thaddeus, or lost knows Judas, according to several stories, was crucified in Edessa, which is either, we don't know whether Turkey or Greece. Simon the Zealot was crucified in 74 AD. In fact, it almost seems like dying for Jesus is the norm for standing up for your faith. Dying for Jesus was what you did to prove your courage for God. But the truth is, there's something a whole lot harder to do than dying for Jesus. And that is living for Jesus. Daily. To live in and out, in good and times and bad. To live for Jesus in sickness and health and poverty and wealth, when it's popular, when it's not popular. It takes guts. And it takes courage to live for Christ. You don't believe me? Ask the woman whose husband's not a Christian and makes fun of her on a regular basis. And yet she still serves him and cares for him. Because that's what God tells him to do. Ask the kid whose parents aren't Christian. And I don't care how old you are, when you have a kid, your parents aren't Christian. It's tough. Ask the guy with little Gary disease 6 months ago was out jogging around the block and now has to have someone stand there and help him go to the bathroom. What is it to live for Christ? The truth is that it requires a lot of courage to stand up and live for Christ. It requires a lot of it. How do you respond to a college professor who tells you that the Bible is full of baloney? And that Jesus really wasn't God, and it was just another fairy tale, just like Krishna or all those other fake gods. How do you handle, deal with a terminal condition yourself? We've had some great examples of that around here in the last couple of years. People who showed what it meant to live when they were dying. How do you respond when someone mentions religion at work or makes a joke about it? Do we immediately turn the other way so we pretend we didn't hear it? Do we make sure that we say something so generic that no one can't get in trouble with it? Or do we stand up and say, hey, that's my God? You know, if Steve actually went to work, because he does, he's throwing the house most of the time. Well, you work from home a lot, don't you? You know? I thought you worked from home a lot. I'm wrong. Okay. So if I go to Steve's work, and I stand in the middle of Steve's office, and I start bad-mouthing Charlotte, saying all kinds of mean things about her, you know what Steve's going to do? He's going to punch me. And he's a big guy, so it's going to hurt. Alright? And he should! If I go up there and badmouth Charlie, he should punch me. Okay? So because I'm bad my mom, my wife, I'd punch her too. Alright? But isn't it amazing that we don't think anything about that? But to just stand up and say, hey, I believe in Jesus. Or hey, I think you got it wrong. Let me tell you what God has. We have lunch with someone who's not a Christian. Do you do what I call the five-second prayer? Or do you actually not pray at all because you don't want them to think you're weird? Or do you ever invite them and say, hey, will you pray with me? Do you ever talk about God? How do you handle it when you get unemployed? Feel like everything's falling apart. Or maybe,
How do you respond to temptation when no one's looking? It takes courage. What do you do when circumstances in life beat you up, throw you down, and just flat out wear you out? Do we stand up? Do we stand out like Peter and John and say, hey, no matter what this world does to me, let me tell you about God who lived past death. Do we stand up and tell? You know, some people are really courageous. Most people pretend they have courage. Christians should never have to pretend. Because we know what lies beyond the grave. We know what real love is. God knows the faith. We know what grace is. And we know who's in charge. So we can stand and be counted. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the love of our Lord and Savior.